Put Your Angels to Work by David O. Oyedepo. Introduction. The ministry of angels has been in existence ever since God created the world. When man was made, the psalmist says he was made a little lower than the angels. Psalm 8 verse 5. That means angels occupy a higher realm of being in terms of strength, intelligence, vigor, power, and might than man. The wonderful news is that their higher realm of operation is for the liberty and comfort of the saints. Are they not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister for them who shall be heirs of salvation? Hebrews 1 verse 14. Angels are sent to minister to the saints. Indeed, there is something principally missing until the angelic dimension of our redemption is brought to light. There are areas a Christian will never cross into until this dimension is in place. And one of the most pronounced ministries of these end times will be that of angels. Just as all the other benefits God has for the church are packaged in mysteries, angelic intervention is also packaged as one of the most sophisticated mysteries of life. Until such mysteries are unfolded, the church cannot utilize or enjoy them. Divine health, for instance, has always been available, yet everyone was walking naturally in sickness and enjoying it. Prosperity has always been for the church, but there was no poorer society than Christians until the light of God's word concerning the redemptive provision of health and riches came to the church. The ministry of angels is available, and the Holy Spirit is given to us so that we may know the things which are freely given to us by God. Until we know that they are given to us and what exactly has been given to us, we cannot experience the benefits of their being given. Neither can we fully reign, because in the kingdom of God to which we belong, we reign by knowledge. Who then are angels? Why are they so relevant to Christian life? What exactly do they do? How can we experience them? What turns them on in our favor? As answers are provided to these questions, the mystery behind angelic intervention will unfold. It is my prayer that as we examine this mysterious ministry, the scales in your eyes will fall off so that you may see the reality of their presence and put them to work. Chapter 1. Who are angels? The angels of God are also referred to in the scriptures as the hosts of heaven or the heavenly hosts. They are real personalities. They are not ideas or mystical figures. Angels are spiritual personalities with physical impact. Like the demonic world is invisible, the angelic world is also invisible. Angels cannot be seen, yet they are all around us. Their physical impact is undeniable. Although you cannot see them, there is nothing the angels of God do not see. You cannot touch them, yet they touch people. You cannot handle them, yet they destroy kings. The Lord assigned just one angel to go ahead of Moses to Egypt, and he alone tortured a whole nation. The angels of God are invincible. This aspect marks the point of departure between angels and demons. Only the hosts of heaven excel in strength. Psalm 103 verse 20. There was war in heaven once upon a time. Michael and his angels fought against Satan and his fallen angels. God used his serving men to confront Satan's retired and ill-equipped army. Satan could not prevail and there was no more place found for him in heaven. Revelation 12 verse 7 to 9. In any conflict, the angels always win in the absolute, flushing out the opposition completely. Angels have never been known to fail. There is nothing that can rise up against you that matches the strength. They constitute the most efficient bodyguards of the saints. Apart from excelling in physical strength, the angels also excel in intellect. The widow of Tekoha, in describing King David's wisdom, likened to that of angels. And my Lord is wise, according to the wisdom of an angel of God, to know all things that are in the earth. 2 Samuel 14 verse 20. In his writing, Lester Sumrall said very stoutly, "We need to establish the idiomatic expression as smart as an angel to acknowledge the wisdom and intellect of angels. What is the relevance of these invisible, invincible, excellent beings? Do we need them as later days Christians filled with the Holy Ghost anointing?" The relevance of angels. A look at the lives of the men of exploits in the Bible reveals that they all enjoyed angelic companionship. An angel appeared to Moses and spoke to him. An angel appeared to Gideon and said he had come to finish the battle for him. Abraham also encountered an angel who paved the way for the realization of his destiny. Lot was safely led out of Sodom by an angel just before the city was destroyed. Daniel excelled in strength and operated the wisdom of angels because he had such sweet fellowship with them. Remember Peter, who was locked up in prison. He was freed and left to safety by an angel. Recall also the man John, who saw what was impossible for natural eyes to see. He said an angel showed them to him, the entire book of Revelation. There is almost no man of worth in scriptures who did not have a physical, tangible evidence of angelic companionship. God has said, "For I am the Lord, I change not. Therefore, ye sons of Jacob are not consumed." Malachi 3 verse 6. It follows that what he did yesterday, he is also doing today. All through the scriptures, there are a total of about 300 references to angelic appearances and angelic operations. The New Testament contains 165 of this number, and the book of Revelation alone contains 65 references. Friend, there is a lot loaded for this era we live in. Angels are an essential and relevant part of God's package for the redeemed. The anointing cannot replace the services of angels. Jesus Christ was born of the Holy Ghost, and he had the Holy Ghost anointing without measure. Yet, he needed the services of angels. I am glad to let you know that Jesus believed in angels, and he enjoyed their ministry, even as the Son of the Most High God. He knew no sin, yet he needed the services of angels even before his birth. An angel announced his coming, and the angel said unto her, "Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God, and behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus." Luke 1 verse 30 to 31. When he was born, a mighty host of angels came amongst the shepherds and declared his arrival. Luke 2 verse 8 to 14. When danger loomed because of the news of his birth, the angel told Joseph to move to Egypt with the baby Jesus, that the scripture may be fulfilled. Matthew 2 verse 13 to 15. After the devil left Jesus on the mountain of temptation, angels came and ministered to him. Matthew 4 verse 11. Angels were there with Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. Matthew 26 verse 53 to 54. One of the most pronounced events are at resurrection, with the angelic operation that rolled the stone away. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. Matthew 28 verse 2. That stone was placed there permanently by the enemies. There was no thought of it ever being moved. I cannot tell what type of equipment was used in placing the stone there, but an angel came and rolled it away. Two angels were later seen at the head and foot where Jesus was laid, John 20 verse 12, symbolizing the two cherubims that would be put around the mercy seats. At ascension, the angels were again present, comforting the men and declaring that Jesus shall come back again the same way he was taken up. Acts 1 verse 10 to 11. I want you to please understand this. Jesus was sent after the order of Moses. For Moses truly said unto the fathers, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren like unto me. Shall ye hear in all things whatsoever he shall say unto you. Acts 3 verse 22. Moses was prophesying in those days of the coming of Jesus. So Jesus came after the order of Moses, and we have come after the order of Jesus. Therefore, if Moses' ministry had angels in it, and Jesus' ministry employed angels at all its phases, then we are to be ministered to by angels as well. God said to Moses, behold, I send an angel before thee to keep thee in the way and to bring thee into the place which I have prepared. Exodus 23 verse 20. There are things prepared for us in this generation also, but we do not have any hope of getting there without acknowledging the ministry of angels. They are the heavenly forces made available to us by God to bring his plan and purpose for our life to pass. God has prepared his manifold wisdom for the last days, and we are going to walk in it. You cannot afford to be grounded or stranded in this period when the church has taken off on a flight. The Lord has said by the mouth of the prophets that my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject thee, that thou shalt be no priest to me. Seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God, I will also forget thy children. Hosea 4 verse 6. If you are born again, the word of God says, it is given unto you to know. Confess the following words out loud to yourself before reading further. I am a disciple of Christ. It is given me by God to know the mystery of the kingdom of heaven. I am a disciple of Christ. He has given me the gift of supernatural insight to unravel heavenly mysteries. Therefore, from now on, no mystery shall be too tough for me to absorb. Lord, I ask specifically, open my understanding to the fantastic ministry of angels. Open my understanding to the mystery of the activity of angels. Help me to appreciate their presence consciously on my side at all times and in all my affairs from today. Spirit of the living God, quicken my understanding, enlarge my understanding, grant me extra insight that I may be able to comprehend all that matters to me as contained in your book. Amen. Chapter 2, The Ministry of Angels. Take a look at God's description of angels in relation to you. And of the angels, he saith, who maketh his angels spirits and his ministers a flame of fire. But to which of the angels said he at any time, sit on my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool? Are they not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister for them who shall be heirs of salvation? Hebrews 1 verse 7, 13, 14. Is it not exciting to know that these flames of fire are available to meet your needs as an heir of salvation? Angels do more than sing in heaven. They wage war on the earth. Every redeemed soul has a company, not just one, of these excellent spirits at his disposal. They are not sent to sit down with you. They are your powerful and militant ministers. Let us examine their ministry in detail. They make the word of God effective. The angels, those fiery forces of heaven, are the performance company of God. They follow the word of God to make it produce. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself, and he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The scripture says his name is called the Word of God, and the army of heaven followed the word. In the Bible, the phrase "the Lord of hosts will perform it" is used frequently. Anytime an outstanding prophecy is given, which cannot be humanly explained, that phrase is used. Mary was told a virgin shall conceive and bear a child called Emmanuel, and the Lord of hosts will do it. God uses the angels, his hosts, to bring his word into effect. When God was going to terminate Sarah's barrenness, he sent an angel. Genesis 18 verse 10. The same thing happened when Elizabeth's barrenness was terminated. Luke 1 verse 11 to 20. The angels of God have the performing rights to act out anything that drops from the mouth of God. They are the assault company that deal with every opposition. They always get the answer and always return triumphant and victorious after every act. They do God's pleasure. Bless the Lord, ye his angels, that excel in strength, that do his commandments, hearkening unto the voice of his word. Bless ye the Lord, all ye his hosts, ye ministers of his, that do his pleasure. Psalm 103 verse 20 to 21. In the curse of making the word of God effective, i.e. doing his commandments, the angels minister God's pleasure to the saints. God said, Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. 3 John 2. That is an instant of God's pleasure, his will for you. The angels are there at your service to bring to pass for you anything that is the will of the Father. They are committed to obeying God's command so you can send them to carry out whatever God has commanded concerning you. The word said, "Say ye to the righteous that it shall be well with him, for they shall eat the fruits of their doing." Isaiah 3 verse 10. It also says, "There shall be no peace for the wicked, and suffer not the rich to live." Exodus 22 verse 18. Who said this? The Lord. What are the angels to do to enforce God's commandments? Therefore, their job is to kill witches, to choke the wicked, so that it may be well with the righteous. As the title, God's commandment is to rebuke the devourer for your sake. Malachi 3 verse 11. The angels therefore go ahead to see that no devourer escapes the judgment of God. The word says, "Give, and it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, and shaken together, and running over, shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure that ye met with, it shall be measured to you again." Luke 6 verse 38. Here, the angels organize the putting across to you. They go around to mobilize funds for you. The will of God is a sound mind, for he has not given us the spirit of fear. 2 Timothy 1 verse 7. Since the angels do God's pleasure, we see an angel go to Daniel primarily to establish this command. "And he informed me and talked with me and said, O Daniel, I am now come forth to give thee skill and understanding." Daniel 9 verse 22. You can go ahead and locate all that pleases God concerning you. The angels have a responsibility to ensure that it is established when so instructed by you. You cause the saints to walk on evil-free paths. Friends, there is an evil zone in life. It is made possible, among other things, by an angelic intervention on every side. When you realize the dignity of God's name and the greatness of his power, the word says he is committed to ensure your all-round safety. The angels are charged to keep you, such that even the toes of your feet are not permitted to be hurt. "Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come near thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he has known my name." Psalm 91 verse 9 to 14. Confess the above words to yourself, saying, "I, my, and me," wherever the scripture has thou, thee, etc. God has directed the angels to keep you in all your ways. They are in charge when you are traveling, sleeping, working in the office, selling in the shop, going to and from church, in all your ways. Your family, your business, even your academic pursuit is in their charge, because they gave Daniel skill and understanding. As you plug into the ministry of angels, you walk on the evil-free path of life. They are a defense in conflict. The psalmist said, "The God of Jacob defend thee, send thee help from his sanctuary, and remember all thy offerings." Some trust in horses, others in chariots, but God will be a defense for those who walk in the covenant. When others are falling, they will be standing upright, because God is their defense. Psalm 20. David kept the angels so busy, he never lost lost any battle all his days. He often pursued his enemies with angels. Let them be as chaff before the wind, and let the angel of the Lord chase them. Let their way be dark and slippery, and let the angel of the Lord persecute them. Psalm 35 verse 5 to 6. Jesus also utilized angels in time of conflict. He stopped Peter from carrying out an act of defense, saying that he was able to call upon God for the release of 72,012 legions angels if he so desired. Matthew 26 verse 53 to defend him. In 2 Kings 19, we read of how just one angel went on a defense assignment and killed 185,000 Assyrian soldiers. Now, if one angel can do that much, imagine what 72,000 angels can do on your behalf, because we also have access to whatever Jesus had access to on earth. Every time God had a battle to fight, he sets the angels loose. Satan waged war in heaven, but the angels of God prevailed. If Satan cursed in heaven, he would not be afraid to do the same in anybody's home. However, angels are all the security we need. That was Jesus' style. They formed a permanent fence for your security. Angels form an impenetrable hedge around every covenant son and daughter of God, which makes them untouchable. Job was blessed with this angelic hedge so much that Satan complained to God about it. Has not thou made an hedge about him and about his house and about all that he hath on every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land. Job 1 verse 10. Unfortunately, Job never saw this hedge, and so he lived in fear, thus making it easy for the devil to attack him. You need to be aware of the angelic shield around you and around all that you have. It is ever present. The psalmist said, "The angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him, and deliver read them." Psalm 34 verse 7. The word encampment is in the present continuous tense, implying they are always there. After Elisha prayed for his servant's spiritual eyes to be opened, he saw the mountains round about full of horses and chariots of fire. 2 Kings 6 verse 17. That was the angelic hedge. Friend, the angels are real. They are always there. They are invisible forces with invincible capabilities sent to minister to us. The devil knows it, so why not use it against him? Tell him now, "Satan, you have no more inroad into my life and affairs. I have the angelic hedge around me, around my house, around all that I have. Satan, shut up there. You cannot get in here. The defenses of God are round about me. Your wicked plan will no more work. I can see the angels. They encamp round me to deliver me. God has given them a charge. They are eternally obedient fighters. They will hearken to the voice of his word. They have a job to bear me up upon their wings. They will make it possible for me to tread upon the lion and the adder, and nothing shall by any means hurt me. I am surrounded." They deliver the saints. Whatever prison the devil has shut you up in, the angels of God will bring you out. Daniel was thrown into the den of hungry lions, but the Lord sent his angel who shut the mouth of the lions. Daniel was the only one who saw the lion's tongue and lived to tell the story. I can imagine him taking a ride on their backs. He was so sure of the ministry of angels that he dared the king to allow justice take its course. The lion must have approached him wagging their tails like pets, thanks to angelic intervention. In the book of Acts, we read of Peter locked up in a prison. season. I believe the saints were praying in Mary's house for the angels of God to penetrate the prison and bring Peter out. While they prayed, the angel of God indeed entered the prison. And behold, the angel of the Lord came unto him, and a light shined in the prison. And he smote Peter on the side and said unto him, saying, Arise up quickly. And his chains fell off from his hand. Acts 12 verse 7. Peter was asleep between two soldiers when the angels appeared, yet the guards were unaware of what was happening. Just by raising Peter up, the chains fell off on their own accord. They did not have to use any key. Peter was safely led out of prison to where the angels were being called on to act on his behalf. And when he knocked at Mary's door, the others disbelieved Rhoda's report, saying it must be Peter's angel at the door, not Peter himself. Peter's deliverance was the neatest in history. There was no mention of his case in court, and he did not have to get out of town. He kept on his crusade. The deliverance involved more than just being released from prison. He was in town, yet could not be touched, because whosoever the Son of God shall set free is free indeed. That is God's commandment for you. The angels ensure that you are free mentally, free spiritually, free socially, free financially, because that is their job. They execute your destiny. When God was going to rescue Israel from Egypt after 400 years of bondage, he sent an angel ahead of Moses to take them out of Egypt to Canaan. Behold, I send an angel before thee to keep thee in the way and to bring thee into the place which I have prepared. Exodus 23 verse 20. We are all children of destiny, which God has prepared for us even before we were born. He said the people he has predestined, he has called. And those he has called, he has justified. And those he has justified, he has glorified. Romans 8 verse 30. You have a glorious future, and an angel has been given charge over your life to ensure that you get to the place prepared for you. Satan tried to mess up the destiny of Joshua, the high priest, by putting filthy garments upon him, but the angel of God ordered their removal and a change of garment for Joshua. Zechariah 3 verse 1 to 5. There is a guardian angel in charge of you. In times of crisis, you may ask for a special dispatch, but there is an angel permanently responsible for seeing that God's plan and purpose for your life is fulfilled. Jesus said, even children have angels, and they behold the face of his Father in heaven. Matthew 18 verse 10. In Lagos recently, a woman shared a testimony of how her runaway housemate returned with her stolen items after her belongings were anointed, confessing that he had done some evil against the family. She said she tried to kill one of the sister's children, but that a man drew a sword and warned that if she dared it, she would be crushed. Now that man with the sword was a child's guardian angel. God said, eyes has not seen, ears have not heard, and no man's heart has conceived the things that have been prepared for them that love God. 1 Corinthians 2 verse 9. The devil is all out to contest the glorious and enviable destiny of the saints, as Paul confirms, for a great door and effectual is opened unto me, and there are many adversaries. 1 Corinthians 16 verse 9. There's a place prepared for you. Satan is mad about it, but he cannot do anything about it, because the word has gone forth. I will build build my church, and the gates of hell shall not be able to stop it. Matthew 16 verse 18. The angels are among God's provisions to clear off all adversaries in your way. There is a place of no sickness on this earth. There is a place of super protection. There is a place of success. Whatever place God has prepared for you in redemption, your angel has a duty to get you there. They release answers to prayers. Then said he unto me, fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that thou didst set thine heart to understand and to chasten thyself before thy God, thy words were heard, and I am come for thy words. How Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia. Daniel 10 verse 12 to 13. It is the pleasure of the Father that when you ask anything according to his will, it is given you. But see how Daniel suffered. He was praying and fasting for 21 days, and the Bible says his request had been granted right from the first day he made it. Angel Michael, prince of Persia, that was standing on the way, a fallen principality, blocked the answer. But by the time a chief principality from heaven got there, the answer was released. For prayer breakthrough, the angels are available on the line. Engage them. They unfold things to come and expand mysteries. Another powerful ministry of angels is the unfolding of things that lie ahead. There are things you have to know about the future, and the angels have a responsibility of showing them to you, as in the case of John the Apostle. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass, and he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. Revelations 1 verse 1. Angels do not only speak of things to come, they also expand mysteries. And the angel said unto me, wherefore didst thou marvel? I will tell thee mysteries of the woman and of the beast that carrieth her, which had the seven heads and ten horns. Revelations 17 verse 7. When prophet Zechariah also saw a mysterious vision, he sought the interpretation through the angel. And I said unto the angel that talked with me, what be these? And he answered me, Zechariah 1 verse 19, I will like you to open your hearts to angelic mysteries henceforth. Expect revelation of mysteries and prophetic insights concerning you from them. Expect mysterious interpretations of scriptures producing very powerful effects in your life through the angels. They will bring to pass things which you never knew existed before. Friends, from now on, see yourself as indestructible. The word of God cannot be broken. By the ministry of angels, you shall tread upon the land and the other unhurt. By their ministry, no evil can befall you, nor any plague come near your dwelling. The angels of God are round about you and round about all that is yours, like an impenetrable hedge of fire. Angels are present helps in trouble, keeping off all adversaries in the path of your glorious destiny in Christ Jesus. They are always around to establish the will of God for your life. However, although already positioned by God to minister to you in the various ways of this curse, you have the responsibility of putting them to work or turning them on in order to fully appropriate their ministration. Chapter 3. How to release your angels effectively. It is necessary to remind ourselves that angelic ministration administrations are saints limited, that is, restricted only to people who have been saved and sanctified by the blood of the Lamb and have their names written in the book of life. In other words, you have to be born again before you can enjoy the ministry of angels to get them to work on your behalf or at your request. God said, "I am the Lord, I change not." Hence, what he did in the past, he is still doing in the present. He cannot change. The Bible exists not for information, but for instruction, for guidelines on what to do or not to do in similar situations and circumstances. The things that were written aforetime were written for our learning. So we need to look deep into the Word to locate the master keys and principal ways which the early saints employed for the effective release of their angels. However, before considering what to do, let us first note not what to do, that is, the factors that might obstruct or delay angelic ministration, even in the lives of the heirs of salvation. Hindrances, blindness. When it comes to the things of God, until you believe it, you cannot experience it. Whatever is written must be seen before it can be possessed. Friends, the unbeatable personalities called the host of heaven are all around us. Job never realized it, and Elisha's servant was also initially ignorant of the fact. Don't let any devil confuse you about the presence of angels. As I said before, just as the demonic world is invisible, the angelic world is also invisible. Have you ever seen the devil on the street? Has the devil ever introduced himself to you before saying, "My name is Mr. Satan Lucifer"? Yet, anytime you find young men engaged in a brawl, or you see an individual on the street who suddenly stripped himself naked, you immediately identify the devil as being around and at work, even though nobody can see him physically on the scene. So is it with the angels of God. Let us look again at the story of Elisha. There was a time when he became so unbeatable and the devil became so uncomfortable. A whole army was delegated to go and arrest him. Therefore sent he 30 horses and chariots and a great host, and they came by night and compassed the city about. And when the servant of the man of God was risen early and gone forth, behold, an host encompassed the city both with horses and chariots. And his servant said unto him, "Alas, my master, how shall we do?" And he answered, "Fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them." And Elisha prayed and said, "Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes, that he may see." And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw. And behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire round about Elisha. 2 Kings 6 verse 14 to 17. What you cannot see, you cannot utilize. Can you see the mountain on which you stand in, full of horses and chariots of fire? The angels of God are flames of fire. And because the word of God rides on the horse, they also ride on horses to execute vengeance and bring deliverance to the saints. Friends, I would like you to see the angels all around you. Angelic ministration was one of the most powerful ministries of the New Testament, which made the saints invincible. Angels were not ideologies to them. Rather, they were real. Every personality and a usual and expected experience. You remember that when Peter knocked at Mary's door after his release from prison, those in the house assumes it must be his angel at the door, not Peter himself. Again, there is no scriptural record to show that Peter expressed any shock or amazement at the appearance of an angel in the prison. The angels were very practical beings to them. To have angelic intervention like they did, and you will begin to operate in the invincible realm. Elisha prayed that the eyes of his servant may be opened, and they were opened. Put two fingers on your eyes and say to them, be opened to see the invisible forces of heaven that are round about me. Be opened in the morning, in the afternoon, and in the night. I command your eyes to be opened to see the angels of God on horses and chariots of fire round about you. Every day, every moment, in Jesus' name. Fear is second hindrance to angelic ministration is fear, and this is a direct result of spiritual blindness. Elisha's servant cried, alas, but his master, recognizing the root of his panic, cured his blindness. Fear has torments and exposes man to the wicked operations of Satan. God has not given us the spirit of fear, but the spirit of power, love, and of a sound mind. 2 Timothy 1:7. God has also told us that, say ye not a confederacy to all them to whom these people shall say a confederacy, neither fear ye their fear, nor be afraid. Sanctify the Lord of hosts himself, and let him be your fear, and let him be your dread. Isaiah 8:12-13. By fearing the things men fear, walking the way they walk, thinking the way they think, and talking the way they talk, the enemy takes advantage of many people and robs them of amazing angelic interventions. There are about 365 instances in the Bible where God says, fear not, or be not afraid. While I mentioned earlier, the word angels appeared 300 times. If you can hearken to God's word and obey his command not to fear, you will indeed see your angels at work. Make God your refuge and your habitation. Then no evil, no matter who is perpetrating it, no plague, no matter what forces are behind it, will have access to you. Make God only your fear and your dread, and he will build a defense around you, just as he said in Psalm 34:7. The angel of the Lord encamped round about them that fear him and delivered them. Friend, until you overcome fear indeed, you do not have access to angelic intervention. But God, in his mercy, has made provisions to destroy the yoke and bondage of fear. How to deal with fear? The anointing. The Bible says the yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. You can anoint yourself against the spirit of fear, particularly when you are out in battle. After the Holy Ghost came on the apostles, they spoke the word of God with such boldness that all those around took notice. Believe God that when you are anointed, there is an impartation of the spirit of boldness that makes you despise things you formerly feared. Knowledge. The anointing teaches all things. Therefore, as the yoke of fear is broken, extra insight into God and his ways is also imparted. More revelation means more strength. And more strength equals less fear. Daniel tells us, the people that do know their God shall be strong and do exploits. Daniel 11:32. The knowledge of God establishes strength on the inside. When you know the worth of God, you know what he is able to do and how he will do it. Consciousness of God's presence and awareness of the ever-abiding presence presence of God establishes great confidence in you, which overrides every fear. David says, though I walk through the valley, the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me. Psalm 23 verse 4. Jesus himself assures us, lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Matthew 28 verse 20. As you overcome the twin obstacles of spiritual blindness and fear, you become aware that the forces with you are stronger than that of any opposition, and then you will be at ease. When you are at ease, God is at work. He said, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. Psalm 46 verse 10. Now your angels are activated and are ready to take instructions from you as you make use of the right keys to set them loose. Keys to releasing the angels. Knowledge. In the kingdom of God, you reign by knowledge. There is no shortcut. If you desire liberty, knowledge is it. Nothing works like the knowledge of the truth, because God cannot deny himself and his word cannot be broken. You shall know the truth and the truth shall make you free. John 8 verse 32. Your liberty in the kingdom anchors on knowledge, not on piety or religious activity as some Christians think. The subject of angels is a very sensitive one. There is no one who can claim to have a grasp of it without doing some deep study. You need to launch into the deep waters of the word when dealing with things that cannot be physically seen. How much you get of your own inheritance as a heir of salvation is determined by knowledge. God is no respecter of persons, and he will not do anything until you know it. We heard a testimony in January 1993 from an ordained minister of the gospel who wrote to us from Ogun State, Nigeria. For 17 years, he was a victim of sickness and disease and was constantly on drugs. From every indication, I believe he was born again and spirit-filled because he was into joint prayer and fasting with an evangelist. After 17 years, this man decided he has prayed and fasted enough. So he walked to a bookshop and bought three different books. He bought one on faith, another on the believer's authority, and the third one on divine health, and he went on a knowledge-seeking adventure. According to him, following the principles and guidelines in the third book, which is written by me, Keys to Divine Health, he declared a three-day war against Satan, and on the third day, he took communion. He said immediately after the communion, the 17-year-old bondage in my life was broken. He became free from drugs for the first time in 17 years. Many are confronted with challenges today and had done nothing about it. When they tell me they have prayed and fasted, I tell them they have a long way to go and may yet die fasting without no result. The accuser is out to put you in jail, so you need an efficient knowledge of the law that guarantees your liberty in all issues of life. There is no recovery without discovery. The man Daniel had an excellent spirit, yet he says he understood by books. Daniel 9 verse 2. Having an excellent spirit was not enough. His understanding became real as he reads books. Insights are brought about by outstanding searches. Friends, discovery is it. You need to settle down. Paul said, study, then you will be approved by God as a workman that will never be ashamed as you rightly apply the knowledge of the truth to the situation of life. 2 Timothy 2 verse 15. Look for books, tapes, audios and video, anything that can add extra insight to you on the subject of angels. As you do so, you will get to a point where you are highly conscious of their companionship and you can relate with them as physical entities. Confidence. The second key to unlocking the doors of angelic intervention is confidence. The devil knows that once your confidence is out of place, you seal off angelic intervention. Is confidence. You seal off angelic activities on your behalf, so he will fight your confidence with all he has. As soon as Job's confidence was shaken, Satan had an access. Job could not trust the God who has blessed him so greatly and kept him. Let us take instruction as we consider the lives of those who by their confidence turned on the angel. Abraham. And Abraham was old and well stricken in age, and the Lord had blessed Abraham in all things. And Abraham said unto his eldest servant of his house that ruled over all that he had, put, I pray thee, thy hand under my thigh, and I will make thee swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and the God of the earth, that thou shalt not take a wife unto my son of the daughters of the Canaanites among whom I dwell. But thou shalt go unto my country and to my kindred and take a wife unto my son Isaac. And the servant said unto him, peradventure the woman will not be willing to follow me unto this land. Must I needs bring thy son again unto the land from whence thou comest? And Abraham said unto him, beware thou that thou bring not my son thither again. The Lord God of heaven, which took me from my father's house and from the land of my kindred, and which spake unto me, and that swear unto me, saying, unto thy seed will I give this land, he shall send his angel before thee, and thou shalt take a wife unto my son from thence. Genesis 24, verse 1 to 7. That was a very mysterious assignment that Abraham gave his servant, to go and fetch a wife who does not know the man she will marry. A difficult task indeed. For see what Abraham said, the Lord of heaven shall send his angels. Verse 7. Abraham has been so familiar with angels at this point that he was so sure of what they were capable of doing. He gave the instruction and held his peace. If you read the story properly, the Lord did exactly as Abraham said. The servant met Rebecca fetching water, and that was it. And the arrangement was so perfect. Everything was in order by reason of angelic intervention turned on by confidence. Hezekiah. This story is a very classic illustration of how the devil operates. The king of Assyria was set to wage war against Judah, and the first strategy was to attack King Hezekiah's confidence, thus hindering angelic intervention. And Rabshakeh said unto them, say ye now to Hezekiah, thus saith the great king, the king of Assyria, what confidence is this wherein thou trusted? Isaiah 36 verse 4. Rather than let you place your trust confidently in God, the devil always seeks to make an agreement with you. See verse 16 of your text. Hearken not to Hezekiah, for thus saith the king of Assyria, make an agreement with me, by a present, and come out to me, and eat ye every one of his vine, and every one of his fig tree, and drink ye every one the waters of his own cistern. Isaiah 36 verse 16. When you are faced with any kind of challenge, know and believe that it is always darkness before dawn. So do not give in to Satan and his gimmicks. By the time God intervened on Hezekiah's behalf, the first command was, "Be not afraid." Isaiah 37 verse 6. An angel of the Lord responded to the switch of confidence as Hezekiah and his men stood firm. Then the angel of the Lord went forth and smote in the camp of the Assyrians 185,000. And when they arose early in the morning, behold, they all dead corpses. Isaiah 37 verse 36. 3. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. King Nebuchadnezzar set up a golden image of himself and commanded that all the inhabitants should bow down and worship the idol whenever trumpets were sounded. The punishment for disobedience was to be cast into the midst of a fiery furnace. The three Hebrew boys refused to bow, and they were brought before the king to defend themselves. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thy hand, O king." Daniel 3 verse 16 to 17. The king was with fury at their response and ordered the furnace to be heated 7 times more than usual. But the voice confidence was in place, and the angels were triggered off to act. As long as your confidence in God is in place, Satan is displaced and the angels take charge. They are the present help in trouble. The angels arrived in the furnace ahead of the boys, causing the heat to burn to death the soldiers who threw them in. For the boys, the heat of the fire was nullified and charged to a cooling effect. The three boys placed their confidence in God, who is a consuming fire, and they came out of the furnace unscratched. Daniel 3 verse 27. Friends, if you will not bow, you will not burn. Daniel, due to his God-given favor with King Darius, the other presidents and princes grew envious and sought to destroy Daniel. They lobbied for a decree ordering everybody to worship no other god but the king himself. Daniel expectedly rejected such an order because he was fully conscious of where he came from and to whom he was connected, even though a captive. He confidently told the king to allow him face the punishment of being thrown into the lion's den, and once again, the angels immediately intervened, as he said the next day, "My God has sent his angel and has shut the lion's mouth, that they have not hurt me. For as much as before him innocency was found in me, and also before thee, O king, have I done no hurt." Daniel 6 verse 22. By my understanding, the angel got into the den ahead of Daniel, just as in the case of the three Hebrew boys in the furnace. A second later would have been too late. I have had a few experiences myself. Sometimes back in 1984, I was driving from Kaduna at about 2 a.m. with three other fellows chatting in the car. Suddenly, I noticed a terrible narrow bridge right ahead, and a big truck was coming in our direction. As soon as the man with me saw the situation, all the loud talking stopped, and the car was as silent as a graveyard. Then the word just blossomed in my heart, "He shall give his angels charge over you." I immediately said in my spirit, "There is no point driving driving this car into the river. God, whether or from under, from above, both this car and all of us in it who are on assignment must cross over. I was so confident, nothing shook within me. Now, how we crossed the bridge, I cannot tell, but we did without any mishap. The signs of relief from my fellow passengers literally shook the car. Confidence is the principal key that turns your angels loose. Before you arrive at a point of confrontation, they are already there to see that no evil befalls you. Confidence in God will always make the angels work in your favor. Paul the apostle said, "For we are the circumcision which worship God in the spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus and have no confidence in the flesh." Philippians 3 verse 3. David, who enjoyed so much of angelic ministration, said, "My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad." Psalm 34 verse 2. Peter was so confident he slept soundly a day before he was scheduled to die. He slept so deep the angel had to tap him before he woke up. That is confidence. It is time to begin to make your boast in the Lord. If you are going for a meeting or an interview, for instance, say, "The angel of the Lord goes before me to dignify my appearance and put in my hands the things that I desire." Speak it just like Abraham did and settle down to see results. The writer of Hebrews said, "Cast not away therefore your confidence, which has a recompense of reward." Hebrews 10 verse 35. Prayer. "Thinkest thou that I cannot now pray to my Father, and he shall presently give me more than 12 legions of angels?" Matthew 26 verse 53. Attempts were made to kill Jesus 11 times, yet he always escaped without a scratch. None of his bones were broken, and from the above scripture we see the secret. Jesus prayed to the Father, and a special dispatch was sent down on the spot. Every time he called on the Father, the angels came on assignment, and he, passing through the midst of them, went his way. We have access to whatever Jesus had access to, because he said before he left, "As my Father has sent me, even so send I you." John 20 verse 21. Jesus revealed how he escaped premature death. You can also pray to the Father, who is a present help in trouble, and he will give you more than 12 legions, 72,000 of angels to come to your rescue. Jesus suffered no loss. You have access to legions of angels to stop whatever is not written concerning you by praying the angels down. Command. This is the fourth key for releasing the angels to work in your favor. The reason why it sometimes seems like the angels are not at your service despite everything is that there is no order from you. It is not enough to bring them down. You have to activate them by your commands. God said, "Concerning the works of my hands, command ye me." Isaiah 45 verse 11. We order the angels of God to take action according to our desires. A perfect instance of this is seen in Elisha's story when he prayed that his enemy should be struck with blindness, and he smote with blindness according to the word of Elisha. 2 Kings 6 verse 18. The action was according to the word Elisha spoke. Jesus in his teaching described the angels as harvesters. He the words we speak as seeds. It means the angels harvest our words by bringing them to pass. Your tongue is the key that turns them on. Anything you say is what they do. That is why God warned Moses, beware of him. Exodus 23:21. We are warned a second time. Suffer not thy mouth to cause thy flesh to sin. Neither say thou before the angel that it was an error. Wherefore should God be angry at thy voice and destroy the work of thy hands? Ecclesiastes 5:6. This is a very powerful clause in the ministry of angels. I wish people took more note of it. In giving orders, speak life all the time. Say only what God has said. This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. The angels go ahead to enforce this order as you say it daily. As you step into your office, say to the angels, open my office doors today for favor, so that anyone who comes in will regard me as a person to be loved, appreciated, and rewarded. When you say, I cannot be sick, the angels see that as a decree and goes to organize your divine health. I have been saying that I cannot be hospitalized for many years. Some people actually got angry with me, but it has not changed my stand. I keep saying, I cannot sleep in an hospital bed. It is too narrow for me. I have no business lying in a hospital. My angels hear me, and they have been carrying it out according to my words. From now on, you should begin to put the angels to work effectively. The supernatural security arranged around you is so impregnable. Satan has no answer to it. The name of Jesus. The reason why God has given his angels charge over you is because you know his name, because he has set his love upon me. Therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high because he hath known my name. Psalm 91:14. When you invoke the name of Jesus, you trigger off the angels. The Bible says, let all the angels worship him. Therefore, at his name, they come in to do his pleasure on the spot. Also, as you release the name of Jesus in faith, a strong tower of angels is built around you. The angel of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous runneth into it and is safe. Proverbs 18:10. In a situation where you cannot think clearly or remember any scripture, just invoke the name of Jesus. There is no emergency under the sun that can overcome that name. A Christian was once involved in the world's most ghastly plane crash. According to his testimony, as he called on the name of Jesus, he miraculously came out to safety through a hole, which was naturally impossible considering the size of his frame. His guardian angel pulled him out to safety, has invoked the mighty name of Jesus. My wife and I were once on a trip when the car began to swerve off the road. My wife started saying, in the name of Jesus, repeatedly. I told her that calling it once was enough. All hell cannot contain the mention of that name. The car was still moving, of course. But I declared boldly, we will not hit the concrete, and we did not. That is the attitude that gets your angels excited. It is your turn to engage them. Jesus said, anyone who is ashamed of me and my word, I will also be ashamed of him before my Father and his angels. Mark 8:38. That means its angels respond to his name and to his word. Do everything in the name of Jesus. Before you go to bed, say, I go to bed now in the name of Jesus. Don't say it quietly. Say it loudly and boldly. Then your angels will rely on for action. You invoke the name of Jesus to compel the dispatch of angels. Friends, the angels are there for you, and the keys to release them have been given. First, you acquire knowledge, then you build up your confidence with God. You pray them in, command them to action, and invoke the arrival with the name of Jesus. Chapter 4, Angels on Assignment. They carry files. 2 Mondays ago, when I came for the business fellowship, the pastor who preached said he was going to do PRO for God. He said he wanted to advertise for God. At the end of the service, I was laughing after I left the fellowship. I had real need for money. I told God, I believe everything the pastor said with all my heart. You say that it is in believing you will do your word. On my way home that night, somebody came to me and told me that one of my old clients wanted to see me urgently the following day. I got there and he signed a check and told me to start the work immediately. As soon as I finished that work, I was given another one, but it was not told how much it was worth. My partner was to travel to Benin. I needed some money to travel with, and we had used the previous money to start this new job. By Wednesday, nothing had been said about this new job. Then I remember something. I had been playing 2 tapes trying to learn more on angels, tape by Bishop and another Kenneth Copeland on ministry of angels. In one of them, Copeland said that in Revelation 1 verse 1, Jesus sent his personal angel to testify of these things, that every believer has a personal angel. So I just went into a room in the bank and said, "Now my angel, I want this money out now." I got there very early in the morning, and by 12 noon, nothing has been said about the money. Immediately, I finished praying. I came out of the room and went to the manager's office. When I got there, he said, "What are all the expenses you need? Write them down." I wrote them with biro, and he approved it there and then. I left the office. Then I said, "No, it is not over." I said I can still do more. I said I want this check out today. I went to the room. I told my angels, "Carry the file from table to table until the check comes out." And the check came out that very day. They repaired cars too. In December, my car had a shaft problem. I sent it to my mechanic, who repaired it and sent it back to me. But within a week, the problem developed again, to the extent that it now affected the brake, which started leaking. I took the car back to the mechanic, who checked the whole thing and gave me an estimate of 5,000 naira. I took the car back home, poured in a bottle of brake oil, which finished in the day. I then used the anointing oil. I poured it into the brake pad and sprinkled the tire with the blood of Jesus at the spot where the shaft was making noise. Then I asked the angels to come and repair the shaft, and they did. For over 3 weeks now, I've been driving the car without brake oil. My mechanic came yesterday and said he had not seen me yet. I said, "Jesus is Lord." They brought my money. I was transferred from Calabar to Lagos late last year. I had some money, including my December salary, stuck there. The money was a large sum, which I did not want to be brought by road to me. I then exchanged my check with a senior colleague who would cash mine over there in Calabar, and I will cash his here in Lagos. On reaching his bank, I found he has less than 200 naira in his account, and this was just after the December picnic we had. I had spent a lot on the picnic because I was expecting the check. I called him on phone, and he told him what happened. he appealed to me to wait for his December salary, which was higher than mine. I waited for it, and when it was paid, it was not up to the amount I wanted to collect. On Friday, after the service, I made up my mind that I must pay my tithe on Sunday. I got cash gifts that helped pay my tithe. I had 100 naira left after that. On getting home on Monday, I placed the 100 naira on the floor and stepped on it, prophesying that I would never lack money in my life. I was told that I had to go to Calabar for my money. I wondered how I could do that with the 100 naira that I had. I then asked the angels to take charge, and they did. On getting home, I placed that same 100 naira in my mantle overnight. To God be the glory. Before 12 o'clock the following day, my money came. I don't know how it came. I just praise God. Arosanya. S. They organized favors for me. Since the teaching on angelic intervention, every day after my morning devotion, I will say, angelic, go with me as I am going. Take control, take charge. Let me meet with favor. Where I live, we have had no light for about 6 months. And so we go to other places to fetch water. But this place I went to, they don't allow non-residents to fetch water there. As I got there in the morning, the man I met there said, "Oga, they don't allow people but fetch." As I was leaving before fetching the water, the man said, if I still wanted to fetch some more, he would wait for me to come back. The following day, I did not go to the office with my car, so I went to the bus stop. There were no buses available, so we all had to wait. Suddenly, a bus came and people rushed towards it, but I walked majestically to the bus. The conductor opened the bus for me to enter, and those who were already seated made way for me to come in and seat. Indeed, angels have been organizing favors for me. And they organized help. Since the bishop said we should be washing our feet, I've been doing that in the morning. I've been anointing my feet and walking around the office, possessing the place. But after his message on angelic intervention, that we should give instructions to our angels, when I got to the office on Monday, I told the angel that I want my work to be fast, and I wanted my work to be fast, and that I don't want any stress on me, and that I wanted them to keep off anyone that was set to despise me. On Monday, I was surprised to find some of my colleagues who handled light duties coming around to help me. This was unusual because previously, except they are forced by the boss, they don't come around. Also, yesterday, there were two colleagues that were all out to despise me. Well, one of them came around yesterday to help me and the other came today. I've noticed these changes. I just give God all the glory and praise. Mama A. The angels blinded their eyes. On the 23rd of January 1995, my assistant and I arrived in Kinshasa Airport on a missionary program in Zaire with several other passengers. We were crowded into an office where we were surrounded by soldiers who, apart from their normal duty of checking our papers and baggages, were out to extort money from the visitors. They searched our bag, nothing. They searched my partner inside out, nothing. No dollars. Two times they made him take off his coat, finding it difficult to believe that he had no dollars on us, nothing. Meanwhile, I had all the mission fund on me in my inside coat pocket, and I was standing right there beside my assistant watching as they searched him desperately, but it never occurred to them to search me. This was because the angels that came to us on that trip made me, who had possession of the money, invisible. Thanks to God for the series of messages on angels which the bishop had preached before our departure from Lagos. Pastor Paul Momo. Chapter 5. Now call on them. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Ephesians 6, verse 10 to 13. The emphasis in the above scripture is the whole armor. It takes the whole to stand. Whatever is proved in the Bible as an instrument for triumph in the hands of God forms a part of the whole armor, so put it on. What God has done in this study on angels is to train us and equip us for war with unbeatable weapons, with the seal of the angelic dimension of our heritage that has been opened. You have no excuse to fail. Abraham took the men of his household and trained them for war. When they went for their first battle, they returned triumphant. Genesis 14, verse 14 to 16. I would like you to believe God that with the angels on your side, the battle is over. When Gideon saw an angel draw out his sword, he asked, "Are you for us or against us?" The angel said, "I am here to finish the battle." The angels are there to draw out their swords against all your adversaries. They are ever around you. They are flames of fire riding upon horses and chariots of fire. Satan knows it, so use it against him. God has handed over to us very mysterious things. We must not frustrate his grace. Is there any area of life where you want to see your angels in action? Now call them on. I don't want to put your expectations in the future. Jesus said, "Don't you know if I pray my Father, he will give me presently?" You want to see the invisible, touchable, angelic hand in your affairs? It is available now. Young men and women looking for spouses, they will bring them to you. They will organize the restoration of every broken home and ensure the reawakening of every dampened business. The angels will roll away every stone that locked you inside the cave and turn every fire burning around you to coolness. They will shut the mouth of every lion about to swallow you up in the name of Jesus.